Good evening. I'm Jason Kelly. I am the director of the IUPUI Arts and Humanities Institute and a professor of history here at IUPUI. And I want to welcome you to this evening's Quarantine Conversations. Quarantine Conversations is in its sixth week. We have a total of seven programs scheduled. So this is our second to last week, and this is the last week where I will be our host. Next week, Ed Comentale will be finishing up the duties of hosting the conversation. The Quarantine Conversations is a collaboration between IUPUI and Indiana University Bloomington. And this is a program that I co-host, as I already mentioned, with Ed Comentale, who's a professor of English and associate vice provost of Arts and Humanities. And the program is a collaboration between the organizations with which we work down in Bloomington, the IU Arts and Humanities Council, and up here in Indianapolis, the IUPUI Arts and Humanities Institute. The program itself is designed to show how arts and humanities can provide useful perspectives and frameworks for understanding and addressing the current historical crisis. The talks cover everything from the disease of COVID-19 to the historical, cultural, social, and experiential dimensions of the pandemic. In recent months, faculty from across the IU system have turned their attention to responding to the COVID-19 pandemic, and many of you have probably seen information about the ways that they've been addressing this in the IU news reports. These individuals include dozens of arts and humanities faculty who have transformed their teaching, their scholarship, and their community engagement to address the challenges facing the residents here in Indiana and beyond. The arts and humanities provide us with valuable tools to respond to this historic moment. They provide us with historical context and interpretive frameworks to better understand the social, cultural, and political significance of this moment. They offer us new ways and different ways to think about our lives. They offer us much-needed critical techniques that have the capacity to affect policy and transform our communities. Art and design are particularly important in this effort as we reflect upon and reshape our worlds. Tonight's topic is humanism, public policy, and medical practice. And I want to give a very special welcome to the alumni who are watching tonight, especially those alumni from IU Bloomington's College of Arts and Sciences and IUPUI's School of Liberal Arts. We appreciate your continued support for our faculty and our work. I also want to thank our friends from the Arts and Humanities Council, as well as Indiana Humanities, and I want to give a quick shout out to our friends Kira Amsutz and Leah Namias, who are always wonderful partners with both the folks up here at IUPUI and down the folks down in Bloomington. I want to encourage all of you to visit their websites, which you can easily find, and make sure to follow them on social media. The work that they do around the state is really amazing, and there is a reason they have the reputation for being the best state humanities council in the country. I also want to give thanks to some of the folks who have made this program possible, specifically Gerard Panacook, Joe Highland, and Ethan Gill. They've just made this completely possible with their technical expertise and their organizational skills. This is not the only program that IUPUI and IUB are offering over the next several weeks, and I want to make sure to make sure that you're aware of the events that Bloomington is doing every Thursday night. I will make sure that we send you a link in the Facebook comments on where you can find more information about that. I also want to invite you to the IUPUI Arts and Humanities Art and Ethics Seminar. Our final one for the semester will be on May 28th at 11 a.m., and you can find out more about that in our social media as well. We have four speakers this evening. I'm sorry, we have three speakers this evening. Each speaker has been asked to begin with a significant object, and that object could be a poem, a painting, a piece of music, and they'll use this to expound upon some ideas, which they will then pursue over the course of their presentation. This object-based approach is a great way to think about the ideas of their presentations and get us thinking about ways that objects help mediate our experiences on a day-to-day in our day-to-day lives. I want to encourage all of you also to make sure to put comments in the Facebook comments section. Put your questions in there as well. At the end of the three presentations this evening, we will have an open question forum. So I will pull the questions from the Facebook page and then pose them to our question to our participants at the end. Our first speaker tonight is Emily Beckman, who is an assistant professor in Medical Humanities and Health Studies, as well as the director of the Medical Humanities and Health Studies program at IUPUI. Her work focuses on literature and medicine, empathy in medical education and practice, medicine in film, and she's been working on a project around the Central State Hospital and the history of institutionalization in Indiana. She's a great colleague, and tonight she's going to be speaking on empathy, patient care, and humanistic training for healthcare professionals.
Thanks very much, Jason. Okay, thanks everybody. It's great to be here. I'm excited to get to participate in this series. It's been fun to tune in on Tuesday evenings. I've learned a lot. And I've been able to make some connections that that otherwise I would not have made. So I initially was going to use the poem that I'm going to discuss as my artifact. But in the last couple of weeks, I've discovered something different. So it's kind of a way to get a piece of art and a poem into this talk. I'm going to show you, let me see if you can see this. Yep, there we go. I'm going to show you this painting as my artifact, but I'm actually not going to talk about it yet. This is a way to encourage you to stay throughout the talk, I guess. I will talk about this at the end of my time. So have a look. This was painted by a brilliant graduate student of mine, Anastasia, as a part of her final project in my Finding Frankenstein course that just wrapped. So. Stay tuned. I will come back to that. So a brief word of caution. This is very much a this is what we need to do talk. So just so you've been warned. So the Medical Humanities and Health Studies program at IUPUI works largely in part, to prepare future health professionals to regard their work as much more than purely scientific and technological. Many of our students, awed by the prowess of contemporary biomedical science, risk developing the impression that diagnosing disease and caring for the sick are strictly scientific matters. The risk of this kind of thinking and training has been made all the more apparent throughout the COVID-19 crisis. In fact, now we realize even more the urgency with which we regard the health professions as arts, as well as sciences, and that tending to particular patients and families in times of crisis invariably calls on knowledge and perspectives better cultivated by courses in the humanities than the sciences. Future health professionals need to grasp the historical and philosophical trajectory of their discipline so that they can be more insightful critics of unquestioned assumptions. They need to appreciate how their discipline fits into the larger and diverse cultures of the people it serves. They need to understand the ethical foundations of their professions so that they can be more effective advocates for their patients. And they need to be familiar with great resources in literature, art, and other humanities disciplines that can help rekindle wisdom and passion for their work while building the capacity for empathy, in spite of forces of overwork and burnout that can result even in the best of circumstances, and certainly in times of crisis. So tonight I would like to focus on empathy, as Jason said, and the role that literature plays in increasing our personal capacity for empathy. We know that empathy plummets while students are in medical school, and then further falls once students enter residency, generally speaking. Certainly this isn't the case for everyone. I don't have time to argue tonight for its value, but I hope that we can all agree that empathy for others is a solid move in the right direction, especially right now. So what I will focus on is the way that we build or rebuild, actually, empathy through our engagement with literature and each other. I will spend most of this evening with poetry, but I can't give a talk on the humanities in medicine without at least a shout out to Mary Shelley, author of Frankenstein. So I'll do that now, and then again at the end of my talk. I should say that, in my opinion, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein is the text which sort of embodies what medical humanities is and sets out to do. So while my primary appointment is in the School of Liberal Arts, I spend a fair amount of time with medical students at the IU School of Medicine, and I have for over 10 years. Gosh, I think it's, well, we'll just say over 10 years now. And while I think fiction, real fiction, is the most valuable for engaging in these kinds of conversations, the poetry that I've chosen for tonight is more autobiographical in nature, but I think more illustrative of what we expect from doctors generally, and in times of crisis more specifically. So this poem by William Carlos Williams, whose reputation among the students is in constant flux, we could talk about that later. William Carlos Williams is one of my favorites and seems to me to be a good place for us to begin. Okay, so I'll read the poem, Complaint. They call me and I go. It is a frozen road past midnight, a dust of snow caught in the rigid wheel tracks. The door opens. I smile, enter, and shake off the cold. Here is a great woman on her side in the bed. She is sick, perhaps vomiting, perhaps laboring to give birth to a tenth child. Joy, joy. Night is a room darkened for lovers. Through the jalousies, the sun has sent one golden needle. I pick the hair from her eyes and watch her misery with compassion. So I generally like to use this poem after discussing, let's see if I can move this, there we go, after discussing Jean Bikey or The Use of Force or even The Girl with the Pimply Face, which are some of my favorite of Williams' short stories. But in the interest of time, I'll just have to recommend them to you. Perhaps you'll read them later this evening or maybe tomorrow morning. That's fine too. So William, switch screens, there we go. All right, so William Carlos Williams was a physician, poet, essayist, novelist, short story writer. He was award-winning writer. Perhaps most well-known for his very short poem called The Red Wheelbarrow. Williams was born and spent most of his life in Rutherford, New Jersey, and I think is known to have delivered something like over 3,000 babies or something like that. His primary patient population was the immigrant poor, and much of what he writes reflects those experiences that he had making house calls and that kind of thing. I love Williams because of his direct, honest, I think really brave style of writing. In his autobiography, he writes about his life as a physician and a writer, saying, "It's the humdrum, day in, day out, everyday work that is the real satisfaction of the practice of medicine. The million and a half patients a man has seen on his daily visits over a 40-year period of weekdays and Sundays that make up his life. The actual calling on people at all times and under all conditions. The coming to grips with the intimate conditions of their lives, when they were being born, when they were dying, watching them die, watching them get well when they were ill, has always absorbed me. That is why, as a writer, I have never felt that medicine interfered with me, but rather that it was my very food and drink, the very thing which made it possible for me to write. That's like quoting from his autobiography right here. Read that too tomorrow afternoon. Okay, so let's talk about, oops, oh goodness. Let's see, I have, oh my goodness. Let me go all the way back. Okay, so I'd like to frame tonight's brief discussion of poetry with the first line of this poem, They Call Me and I Go, and the last line of the second poem that I'm just gonna briefly mention at the end. This is a pretty straightforward to frame a discussion, but I think putting these two poems together really works well to define sort of our expectations, the expectations that we have for those who care for us, doctors, nurses, and others. So the first line of this poem, They Call Me and I Go, and it ends with a period. It's very deliberate. It's very direct, definitive. I use this with fourth year med students most of the time. And we talk about what this means, what this implies. It implies more than a suggestion, maybe a duty, maybe more than that. It's very automatic. They call me, I go. There's no question. And this seems to be very representative of what it means to be a doctor, especially right now, right? There's no sort of snooze button, no putting this off until tomorrow. While the they in the sentence is not entirely clear, and the destination seems pretty irrelevant, at least to the doctor, the directive is there. They call me and I go. Whoever it is needs me wherever they might be. They call me and I go. The next stanza, it is a frozen road past midnight, a dust of snow caught in the rigid wheel tracks. The punctuation doesn't complete this stanza, but for a moment, it's worthwhile, well, with the students, we spend a lot more than a moment, but it's worthwhile to think about a frozen road past midnight. What does that mean? What do you see? What do you think of? What do you imagine? You know, I think many of us probably have different ideas of what midnight means, depending on who we are, what we do for a living, if we're late night people or early risers. For me, it always reminds me of my teenage years when my dad used to say nothing good happens after midnight. But we think about midnight as being very dark, very still, right? Most of the world, we like to think, at least near where we are, since we're sleeping. And then a frozen road that extends beyond that, you know, might lead us to think, obviously, of something very cold, but also desolate, hopeless, even death, perhaps. So it's worthwhile to sort of imagine what this is, what image does it conjure up, where do we go from here? The door opens, I smile, enter, and shake off the cold. We could spend a lot of time thinking about this stanza as well. We still don't know, we being the doctor in this case, we still don't know why we're here. But the door opens and in we go. We are there for a reason. We must enter, not knowing what exactly we're going to find, right? We can be quite sure that Williams wasn't getting updates via electronic medical record on his phone, certainly. This was early to mid 20th century. And we're not sure what we're going to find, but we have to enter. We have to smile, right? And shake off that feeling of sort of hopelessness or desolation or whatever it is that we associated with the cold. Here is a great woman on her side in the bed. She is sick, perhaps vomiting, perhaps laboring to give birth to a 10th child. Joy, joy. Now, if we had a lot more time, I would ask you all, how did you read this stanza to yourself? Right? Did you read, here is a great woman on her side in the bed. She is sick, perhaps vomiting, perhaps laboring to give birth to a 10th child. Joy, joy. Maybe. Or would you read, here is a great woman on her side in the bed. She is sick, perhaps vomiting, perhaps laboring to give birth to a 10th child. Joy, joy, right? The way we read the poem says a lot about where we're coming from and how we interpret the story and what's going on. Oops. Yep. Night is a room darkened for lovers. Through the jealousies, the sun has sent one golden needle. So I would ask us to consider, what is the golden needle? What does that imply? Is it hope? Is it one last sort of breath? What is our interpretation and why does it matter? And then finally, this is it. I pick the hair from her eyes and watch her misery with compassion. Williams is often interpreted, at least by my students, as being cold and distant and sometimes inappropriate. We are usually able to work through it and move past and see beyond, but that's usually sort of the initial response. So when we come to something like this, a stanza like this, that's just full of empathy or something that resembles empathy, it's difficult to associate it with the Williams that that we might see in those short stories that I mentioned earlier. Why does he do this? Why does he pick the hair from her eyes? Why does he watch her misery with compassion? Is it all he can do? To me, it's reminiscent of the Whitman poem, actually, that was mentioned earlier in the series, A Sight in Camp in the Daybreak, Gray and Dim, when Whitman describes the lifting of the blanket. He says, curious, I halt and silent stand, then with light fingers, I from the face of the nearest, the first just lift the blanket. It seems like when we can do nothing else, when we're sort of overwhelmed with hopelessness, desperation, exhaustion, we end up relying on something like compassion or empathy. And I think that's what we see here at the end of this poem. Such a tender, sort of gentle gesture to move the hair from her eyes. And I think this is often motivated by simple curiosity or awe at what we are witnessing. And we don't learn this in biochemistry. What we learn in biochemistry is very important, but we don't learn this in biochemistry. All right. Oh, goodness. Oh, goodness. Okay. Whoop. All sorts of problems. Okay. All right, so a common response to all of this time spent in the humanities in hopes of providing context and developing empathy is that it simply takes too much time and energy. I'd like to introduce now, very briefly, a poem by John Stone. It's one that I use much less frequently, but I think it is particularly poignant right now. It's less ambiguous. There's less, I think, to sort of imagine, though there's just as much to discuss. But the last stanza reminds us that our students, our physicians, our nurses, are also people who have to leave the hospital. They have to leave the clinic. They have to leave our bedside eventually and go home. Those we charge with caring for those who are most vulnerable are, you know, at the end of the day, at the end of the shift, just people. So I think I lost my screen share here, so I'm going to do it again. All right, there we go. All right, so this poem, Talking to the Family, written by John Stone, my white coat waits in the corner like a father. I will wear it to meet the sister in her white shoes and organza dress in the live of winter. The milkless husband holding the baby, I will tell them. They will put it together and take it apart. Their voices will buzz. The cut end of their nerves will curl. I will take off the coat, drive home, and replace the light bulb in the hall. So if we put this all together, well, if we the first line of the Williams poem and the last line of the Stone poem, okay, the last line of the Stone poem, then we have a really interesting way to frame the way we think about the responsibility of our caregivers in general. I tend to speak about doctors because I teach in the medical school, but I certainly don't mean to leave anybody else out. So with this, we consider empathy in general, social isolation and balance more specifically today, the tension between increasing personal empathy to meet patients in a productive space, provide better care, with the reality of the need to isolate and protect ourselves and our families is very real now more than ever. We can use the poem as a leaping off point to work it all out. We play with it. We turn it around. We compare it. We rewrite it. We act it out. We paint it and apply it. And of course, we can do this with all sorts of things, short stories, essays, novels, pieces of art, etc. All of these things have the capacity to take us places we've never been before, and that is where the magic happens. So in sum, what I'm trying to convey, and I wish we had lots more time to talk about it, is the importance of the arts and the humanities and the education of those who will eventually care for us when we need it most, like right now. We rely on them to constantly redefine and refine and revise and rewrite our perspectives. How do we read the poem? Can we imagine ourselves as the characters? How would we respond in a similar situation? I promised a second shout out to Mary Shelley. It's really hard for me to not talk about Frankenstein. And so we might ask ourselves, those of you who are fans as well, how do we understand Frankenstein's creature? Is he a lost child? Is he a terrible monster? Is he somewhere in between? So I hope that you can see on the screen now three of representations of Frankenstein's creature painted by, like I said, my grad student, Anastasia. I close with this to remind us that even as our as individuals, our interpretations of the same story vary often significantly. So all the more reason to engage with others as we work through different parts of the story to expand our understanding, consider our bias, and think about its application. We are charged with helping our pre-health and medical students understand the broader humanistic context of their professions. In the United States, over 21,000 college graduates commence medical studies each year, and far more than that enter nursing school. Many of these students pursue an undergraduate curriculum heavily focused on natural and clinical sciences with minimal exposure to humanistic disciplines. This renders all the more important development and support of undergraduate educators who can offer courses in the humanities relevant to these students' career interests. Undergraduates who might otherwise eschew courses in such humanistic disciplines as history, philosophy, literature, and others may be drawn to courses that explore the interface between the humanities and health professions. And we should see this continue beyond undergraduate education into medical school and nursing school. At the Indiana University School of Medicine, we are just about, in fact, we're a week out from beginning the first class of the first ever scholarly concentration in medical humanities, which will offer an interdisciplinary course of study drawn from the liberal arts. Medical students will, for the first time at IU, have the opportunity to study more comprehensively and in depth the social, cultural, and humanistic determinants and consequences of health, disease, and healing from literary, historical, and bioethical perspectives, among others. It's up to us as we train future healthcare professionals to continue to examine and revise our perspectives as we move toward a more empathetic way of being. All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Emily. The next person who is going to be speaking this evening is Krista Hoffmann-Longtin. Krista is Assistant Professor of Communication Studies and Assistant Dean in the IU School of Medicine Office of Faculty Affairs and Professional Development. Her research focuses on communication, communication education in the sciences and health professions, faculty development, and organizational and professional identity. Krista leads IU's institutional affiliation with the ALDA Center for Communicating Science, serves as the co-editor for the Public Library of Science's Science Communication blog, and runs a graduate minor in communicating science at IUPUI. And yet another, I introduced Emily as a great colleague, but so is Krista. I have three great colleagues here tonight. And Krista is going to be speaking on doctor-patient communication in the era of COVID-19.
Thank you so much, Jason, for that kind introduction. And I'm so excited to follow Dr. Beckman in this quarantine conversation because I think that our work dovetails so well together. Although medicine, as Emily said, is both a science and an art, the role of improvisation and adaptability in patient-provider conversations is more important than ever in a time of crisis like this. So tonight, I hope to talk about how the tenets of improvisation can be helpful tools for both patients and providers in framing our conversations. But first, with the help of our great tech support, Gerard, I would like to start with a little bit of Miles Davis from his album Kind of Blue. This is about 30 seconds or so of one of my favorite tracks, All Blues. And I'm going to step out of the frame so you can listen. Thanks so much, Gerard. I hope that that kind of situated us into this context of thinking about improvisation. One of the greats there, Miles Davis, doing some improv with a colleague. So as we start our conversation, I'm thinking about this in terms of not only what theater as an improv act can teach us, but also obviously what music can teach us, because I think all of these together, these arts together, are what make this work interesting. So let's see if we can move to the next slide here. So you just heard a little bit of All Blues. All Blues is the second to the last track on Miles Davis' seminal album, Kind of Blue, released in August of 1959. There were people waiting in line at record stores to buy it on the day it came out. It's the best-selling jazz album in the Columbia Records catalog. And at the end of the 20th century, it was voted one of the 10 best albums ever produced. To me, the staying power lies not just with the genius of Miles Davis, rather in times of quarantine, I think that we have something to learn from him here. In his 2007 piece called Jazz and the Art of Medicine, one of my good colleagues, Paul Hedet, who's a distinguished professor of medicine at Penn State, wrote, "Miles Davis's brilliance as an improviser manifested itself not so much in what he played as in what he did not play. To hear a solo by Miles is to hear space. Miles does not play a lot of notes, he just plays the right notes. And he conserves notes, playing them at a relaxed pace, playing on the back end of the beat and dropping musical hints that allow the listener to use their imagination to fill in the phrases. The effect in songs such as All Blues is that it becomes easy to hear not only the solo, but also what the rest of the band is playing. The solo voice gently leads one to hear the sum total of the music, not just the soloist's musical statements way out in front, but those statements within the broader context of the whole band." And I think what Davis's work sort of helps us to think about here is that there is much to be learned about ourselves and one another by leaning into rather than resisting the unknown and that sense of collaboration around the world. And certainly few scenarios have more unknowns than a new virus spreading rapidly throughout the world. So as Jason mentioned, I am a teacher and a researcher. I study communication training methods primarily for scientists and physicians. I've also been consulting with some folks in the medical school and our other health officials in the state of Indiana over the past few weeks about how to talk about COVID-19, both to patients and to providers. And although my training and communication and rhetoric serve me well in these contexts, I often rely upon the principles of improvisation, whether that's theater or jazz, to teach the mindsets I think that we need to develop really effective and empathetic messages. I think we can learn so much from these principles, whether we're communicating at the bedside or even in a public forum to potential patients. But to learn from improv, I think that you need to know a little bit about where it came from. So this is a picture of Viola Spolin. And when most people think of improv, they think of comedy, like the television show Whose Line Is It Anyway, or the famous theater group in Chicago, The Second City. Many of their alums have gone on to be famous comedians like John Belushi or Tina Fey. But improv really didn't necessarily start in the United States anyway as a comedic act necessarily. Viola Spolin, who you see in this picture as a theater artist and educator who is considered by most to be the foremother, if you will, of improv in the United States. And she didn't set out to use improv to make people laugh. In the 1920s, Spolin was a student of American sociologist Neva Boyd. And together, they worked together with Jane Addams' Hull House settlement in Chicago, providing educational opportunities for working class people and immigrants in the surrounding neighborhood. Her technique, which she called theater games, included many of the principles and exercises that form the basis of today's most common improv practices, like acting out non-human roles or placing a set of specific limitations on an improv scene. Spolin believed that her games not only helped people from different backgrounds interact easily, but could potentially open practitioners up both emotionally and spiritually to connect with those that they served. So as we think about kind of connecting this back to Miles Davis, he once said, if you put a musician in a place where he has to do something different from what he does all the time, that's where great art and music happens. Excuse the his there. Over the past few weeks, I've read countless emails and frequently asked questions documents aimed at quelling the concerns of ever nervous public and practitioners. And the messages have a few things in common. There's no script, we don't have the answers to many questions, and the minute that something is written, it's outdated. With so much uncertainty, my goal is always to communicate accurate information at a level my audience understands. And I think that that's the rub with COVID-19. We just don't know enough about the science to communicate with absolute certainty. However, there are some things that we do know, right? Washing your hands, not touching your face, which I probably have done a million times already, physically distancing yourself from others and staying home if you're sick, all can help. However, with more people quarantining at home and now potentially some restrictions being lifted, we know that a steady diet of all of that news is not necessarily going to make us feel better. So what I wanted to do over the next few minutes is sort of share with you some of the principles that really guide my thinking and my thinking as I train, like Emily does, our future practitioners, and think about how the principles of improv can apply to the context of communicating this really complicated information, whether that's at the bedside or in a more public forum. So this is another one of my favorite musicians. This is trumpeter Wynton Marsalis. He once said the real power and innovation of jazz is that a group of people can come together and create art, improvised art, and can negotiate their agendas with each other. And that negotiation is the art. And one of the things that Spolin often talked about, and you see a lot of jazz musicians, particularly Davis, for example, talk about, is the concept of an ensemble mindset or thinking as an ensemble. In improv, when Spolin speaks of the concept of ensemble, she's talking about a group of improvisers who function collaboratively together, constantly giving and taking. Ensemble members know what one another is good at and amplifies one another's talents. This kind of connection comes from a mix of interpersonal connection, hyper-focus, and trust, three things that are hard to get in a crisis environment, or worse yet, over a telehealth visit with your practitioner. However, there are things you can do to help create it, both as patients and as providers. So we can tune into one another, just like musicians tune when they tune their instruments. We can minimize distractions in the room. We can try, when possible, to accommodate one another's approach to communication. So thinking about the concept of metacommunication, talking about talking. If you're a patient, saying out loud what your preferences are, or if you're a practitioner, letting patients know how they can get in touch with you. So thinking about what two notes together sound like in harmony and really trying to tune in together. To patients and providers, you might cultivate this mindset by acknowledging that each of you have expertise in a care environment. Doctors are experts in biomedical processes. Patients are experts in their experiences. Paul Haddad, who I mentioned earlier, argues, ensemble improvisation is the process that makes shared decision-making possible because it allows all voices to find common ground about the decisions to be made. Another tenet of improv focuses on the idea that there is no star of the show, that it's every actor's job to make the scene partner, their scene partner, look good. When communicating about something as serious as a global pandemic, it's easy to get frustrated and lose focus on the big goal. We might get frustrated because a patient or a member of the public is missing your message or dismissing scientific information. You can try to make your scene partner look good. So try working from the same framework. What are the values, passions, and concerns that you share? You heard a little bit of All Blues at the beginning of this conversation. And what's so powerful about that piece of music is that it was recorded all in one take. The band didn't come into the song blind, though. All Blues uses a familiar, relatively familiar jazz framework. It starts with an intro, and then it moves into a head or a shared melody. Then each instrument has a solo that's about the same amount of time, then it goes back to the head, and then it fades out. Going into that recording, it's likely that Miles Davis had at least planned or shared that basic structure, including the sequence and number of solos. So it was the framework, that familiar framework, that allowed for the improvisation to be as rich and beautiful. So what might it look like for patients and providers to work from the same framework? Again, consider the values, passions, and concerns that both patients and providers might share. You both likely want to keep your family and others safe, healthy, and happy. Although the approaches you take might be different, focusing on what you share can often help you to come to a sense of common ground. But I don't want to sort of be Pollyanna and not acknowledge the fact that sometimes your scene partner doesn't want to make you look good, or they don't have enough information to make you look good. And here's where improvisers, I think, can help again. We accept the reality that our scene partners give us, even if we don't like it. So that doesn't mean sharing false information or allowing negative behavior to continue, but it means approaching that conversation from that place of partnership, from that place of inquiry. So a question like, tell me more about how you came to that conclusion, can go a long way. Did they read incorrect information? Did they trust a family member more than their physician or scientist? If you can understand the context, you can often come to that place of shared values. So many of the problems that we have faced within the COVID crisis are not about health or science. They're about communication. Do audiences believe the information we're sharing? Do people trust public health officials? Things are changing so rapidly. How do we take back something we said an hour ago? While you might not have time for an improv class right now, who knows, you're at home a lot, there's great online ones available. I hope that you can see the ideas as a lens through which to communicate. In fact, most of what I'm advocating for here is a shift in how we think about communication, especially during times of crisis. These principles are designed to really focus on, being kind to ourselves, on being kind to one another, and giving one another the benefit of the doubt. Some people are naturally better at communicating, no matter how stressful the situation. We certainly can't be expected to be at our best, especially when so much is uncertain. However, as a professor of communication, I have to believe that good communication can be learned. So perhaps like playing an instrument, the more that you use these principles, the better you'll become. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Krista. That was great. Our final speaker this evening is Anne Beeson Royalty. Anne is professor of economics at IUPUI and director of the PhD program in economics. Her research is on the organization of physician practices and its effect on delivery and cost of care and the employment effects of the Affordable Care Act. And that's just a small portion of all the wonderful research that she does. Anne's presentation tonight is on successful healthcare policies from an international perspective.
Thank you. Thank you, Jason. Before I start, I just have to say that those were two excellent and fascinating talks. I'm going to take this conversation in a somewhat different direction, but I feel honored to follow Emily and Krista. So all of these talks start with a significant object. So let me introduce you to my object. It's an unusual place, Harlaxton Manor, the home of Harlaxton College. Harlaxton College is an American study abroad campus for the University of Evansville, and it's located in the village of Harlaxton, England. American students study here each fall, spring, and summer. They live in the manor, and they often have their classes in the staterooms. Here they are in the long gallery for their British Studies lecture. My husband, who normally teaches at Wabash College, was a Harlaxton visiting faculty member in spring of 2020. So I was at Harlaxton Manor in mid-March when all hell broke loose for Americans traveling in Europe. Not only was I in Europe, but I was there to study international healthcare systems. So my object, Harlaxton Manor, represents my experience of living there when we personally first confronted the coronavirus pandemic, and also my research into the healthcare systems of the UK and the Netherlands. The project I was working on, currently paused, is called Right Under Our Noses, Adapting Successful Healthcare Policies for the US by Understanding English and Dutch Attitudes on Healthcare. The idea is to uncover new approaches to US healthcare reform based on policies in these countries, but knowing that such policies would need to be adapted for the American context. So I set out to learn what attitudes or values influence the organization of the English and Dutch healthcare systems so that I could understand how they might be adapted for the US setting. I planned to learn this through in-person interviews, thus the pause in that research. So back to Harlaxton Manor. In January, February, and the first half of March, I was living there and working on this project. I spent a lot of time working in this beautiful room. I was talking to people I know and setting up interviews in the Netherlands. Then, when, as I said, all hell broke loose, I canceled interviews and other travel and we returned to the US. But in the midst of a pandemic, the underlying motivation for the project, that the US might have a lot to learn from other countries about how to organize and finance healthcare and health insurance, is all the more relevant. But first, why did I think we could learn from other countries in the first place? Because the US spends twice as much or more for healthcare per capita than most European Union countries to achieve, in many cases, lower quality outcomes. So here's a slide looking at costs. Along this horizontal, we have income levels, GDP per capita, so that we can compare similar countries. And going vertically, we have healthcare spending per capita. And you can see all these countries plotted, and then the US up here. So for our level of income, we are spending way more per capita on healthcare than other countries. At the same time, in a lot of dimensions, it doesn't seem like we're getting more for that extra money that we're spending. In fact, here I'm showing you a graph of the growth in life expectancy over time. This goes from 1980 to 2016. And you can see that the US in green is not the life expectancy is not increasing as fast as it is in other comparable countries. So some countries are doing things better and at lower costs than we are. I will quickly tell you a little about the healthcare systems of the UK and the Netherlands, just to give you a sense of how healthcare systems can differ from ours. The UK's National Health Service, everybody calls it the NHS, covers everyone. There's no charge to patients for most services. The healthcare is funded by general tax revenue, and care is reasonably comprehensive, but patients can buy supplementary insurance to provide for faster access to physicians or for additional provider options. Most primary care practices are private and contract with the government, but hospitals are public. Those that provide NHS covered care are public. An important quality indicator in the English system is the length of queues. That is, in American English, waiting times. So waiting times have been generally increasing in the last decade. In contrast, in the Netherlands, residents are required to buy health insurance, and insurers are private nonprofits. Insurers must accept anyone who wants to enroll. That is, no cream skimming of only the most healthy people. Premiums are not based on health or any other personal characteristics, including age. And the premiums are subsidized by the government. The size of the subsidy depends on income, and the subsidies are financed by earmarked taxes. So the system overall takes advantage of market forces, but with strong regulations to address the complexities of healthcare and health insurance markets. For some time, I have thought that perhaps the most important thing that Americans might learn from Europeans in the healthcare realm is simply the importance of having a system. My conversations with European healthcare folks only reinforce that idea. Health economists, when making international comparisons, tend to use the word system. For example, every year the Commonwealth Fund puts out a publication titled International Profiles of Healthcare Systems. But the US doesn't actually have a system. It has a patchwork of separate moving parts, public programs, private insurers, employer-provided insurance, physician practices, nonprofit hospitals, for-profit hospitals, et cetera. A real system can include many moving parts, but by definition, moving parts that are designed to work together as a whole. The Netherlands has an explicit healthcare system philosophy, access to healthcare for all, solidarity in health insurance by sharing risks across the national community, and a commitment to high quality healthcare services. There are then four healthcare laws that address different parts of the healthcare system that are meant to uphold this philosophy. The NHS in the UK has a constitution explicitly setting forth seven principles. I'll just tell you the first two. NHS services are available to everyone, and access to those services depends on clinical need, not the ability to pay. So you can see how those principles lead directly to who gets health coverage in the UK. So my point is that most European countries have a set of principles and have developed a healthcare system where the components of the system have been designed to work together, to be coordinated to uphold those principles. Not that they always work perfectly, of course. There are failures in every country. but at least there's a coordinated system to start from when failures need to be addressed. And you can see from my short descriptions of the UK and the Netherlands, the systems are not one size fits all. They can be quite different from each other with different philosophies. About the only two things these two countries' systems have in common is universal health insurance coverage and substantially lower costs than the United States. So let me now show a few statistics comparing our healthcare system to those of other countries. I've chosen the characteristics of the system that affect preparedness for a worldwide health threat like COVID-19. These statistics are taken from an excellent resource called the Peterson KFF Health System Tracker. I've chosen a small set of countries with comparable income levels to the US, plus I included in Italy because of the large number of COVID-19 cases. And let me give you a heads up. Keep an eye on Germany in these graphs. One area in which the US is a complete outlier as compared to most developed countries is in the percentage of the population that is insured. You can see here the group of countries I'm looking at is US, France, Netherlands, Canada, Germany, Italy, Sweden, and the UK. And you can see that every one of those countries except the US has either 100% of its population covered or very, very nearly 100%. The US, meanwhile, is just over 90%, of the US population is insured. Having more people uninsured in an epidemic is a liability for the country as a whole, not just the uninsured themselves. As you would assume, because of the high cost of care, people with no insurance go to doctors and hospitals less frequently than those with insurance. Not getting diagnosed for COVID-19 means the uninsured are more likely to spread the virus. They are also more likely to have more severe cases because they have untreated underlying health conditions. This graph shows you, for the same group of countries, the percent of adults with cost-related access problems in medical care in the past year. In other words, these are the adults who have foregone medical care because of their costs. And you can see that the US has the highest proportion of these adults. Between 30 and 35% of adults report having had this problem in access because of cost. And the other countries are all substantially lower than the US, with Germany the lowest at maybe about 7% of adults reporting this. You may have read over the last weeks a lot about the idea of flattening the curve. Flattening the curve, that is lowering the peak or peaks in COVID-19 cases on a daily basis or a weekly basis, is meant to prevent our healthcare system from being overwhelmed and unable to care for everyone who needs it. Our medical response to the virus, by necessity, depends on the capacity of our healthcare system. Our high rate of uninsurance is also related to capacity. Let me tell you why. This graph shows you hospital employees per 1,000 people. Except for the Netherlands, those employees are divided up into two types. The sort of mustard-colored bars are the total hospital employment of the country per 1,000 people. And the reddish-orange bars are the hospital staff that actually provides healthcare. You can see that in the US, we have the highest number of total hospital employment and almost the lowest, only a little higher than, only higher than Italy. We have the number of hospital staff who actually provide healthcare. A lot of American non-healthcare hospital workers are working in billing departments. They are trying to get their hospitals paid, but they are having to deal with billing and payments from our dozens of different insurers and hundreds of different insurance plans, as well as Medicare and Medicaid. If we had a more coordinated health insurance system, we could keep the same number of hospital workers, but many more of them could be providing care, or we could operate with fewer hospital workers and lower our costs. We also have, well, the U.S. is in the lower group, but more at least in the middle, in the number of acute care hospital beds per 1,000 people. And once again, Germany, in this case, Germany's the outlier in the good sense of having way more hospital beds than any of the other countries. But let me end this section of the talk with a story rather than a statistic. Some of you may have seen this story the other day. As the New York City crisis was accelerating in late March, Elmhurst Hospital in Queens, New York was overwhelmed. People were literally dying in the halls. Yet there were hospitals only 20 minutes from Elmhurst that had plenty of empty beds. But there was no coordination between these hospitals, no system connecting them. People were dying in the halls at Elmhurst Hospital. A system that coordinates the moving parts of healthcare, in this case hospitals, can save lives. Governor Cuomo's staff did cobble together some kind of system in the days following, but only after the apocalyptic scene at Elmhurst unfolded. These graphs illustrate that on many measures of preparedness, other countries were better off than the US as the pandemic started. I attribute this to the coordination built into their systems. But after doing my best to convince you that we have things to learn from other countries and that we need a more coordinated system, I'll now say that no country had a blueprint for dealing with this new virus. There were too many unknowns. And so it's not only about the healthcare system of a country. There were many decisions that had to be made without all the information that one might want to make a good decision. So how have other countries fared in this crisis? Which have done best? But as we discuss this question, keep in mind that we do not know the ending of this story yet. So I'm going to show you two measures right now of how countries have fared in the crisis. But there's no one pure measure of success or failure in this pandemic, because the first thing I'm going to show you is COVID-19 cases per 100,000 people. But COVID-19 cases can also, the reporting of COVID-19 cases can also depend on how much testing you're doing. And COVID-19 cases and COVID-19 deaths, which I'll show you next, can be affected by completely different things like the average age of your population. But this is what I'm going to show you because this is what we've got. You can see that for the cases per 100,000 people, the US is the highest at just over 400 cases per 100,000 people. And we go down to Italy, which you know had a terrible time a little earlier than the rest of the countries. And then kind of grouped together as having the lower number of cases are Canada, France, and Germany. These are COVID-19 deaths per 100,000 people. The US is kind of more or less in the middle on deaths, with the UK doing very poorly along with Italy. And again, Germany comes out ahead in using this as the measure that we're looking at. So there's some reasons that Germany looks good. We already saw that Germany has 100% rate of insurance coverage, the lowest rate of adults foregoing needed medical care, the second highest of these countries in healthcare hospital personnel per capita, and by far the most hospital beds per capita. But there's some other things Germany did well that we haven't talked about yet. In terms of pre-existing capacity, they had many more ICU beds per capita than other countries with ventilators. They had a stockpile of personal protective equipment such as masks. They also took early action. By mid-January, there was a hospital in Berlin that had developed a vaccine and posted the formula online. Laboratories started stocking up, and before the first German death from the virus on March 11th, they had large stockpiles of tests. Also, the German lockdown was only 9 days after the third death in Germany, whereas in the UK, that took 15 days. They also had decisive leadership with clear messaging. On March 18th, German Chancellor Angela Merkel gave her first national televised address beyond her annual addresses at New Year's. She's been chancellor since 2005. She said, "This is serious. Take it seriously." She said, "Since the Second World War, there has not been a challenge for our country in which action in a spirit of solidarity on our part was so important." And she said, "I firmly believe that we will pass this test if all citizens genuinely see this as their task." You can see visually some of Germany's successes, or sort of an outline of their success in these pictures from the Johns Hopkins COVID-19 dashboard. You can see the bottom slide is the United States and the top is Germany. Along here we have days. So we started, this is March here, and this is just a few days ago here at the end. And these bars are the number of daily cases reported in the country. So you can see in the US we went up and then we're coming down maybe a bit slowly. Although most of this downturn here is due to decreases in the cases in New York City and not due to overall decreases in the US. Germany, on the other hand, with its higher capacity in the health system and its early action and its clear direction from its chancellor, came down much quickly. So they did better than flattening the curve. They're depressing the curve. And I think those are the main reasons for that. And most of the reasons for Germany's doing relatively well are also true of the other countries that have fared relatively well. These countries I'm going to list are less similar than Germany to the US, but they also had higher capacity, took early action, and had decisive leadership with clear messaging. These are places like New Zealand, Taiwan, Iceland, Australia, and Greece. But back to Harlaxton Manor. In hindsight, maybe it seems like a no-brainer to come back to the US as soon as the study abroad students were sent home. But as you may remember, or maybe not if lockdown has begun to feel like it's lasted forever, but back in mid-March, things were not clear at all. There weren't that many known cases in the UK and only a couple of deaths. We were weighing known risks, such as traveling through Heathrow, Atlanta, and Detroit airports, with just sitting tight there in the English countryside. We were weighing the fact that all the Brits around us had health coverage and paid sick leave, whereas that's not so in the US. We were also constrained by the fact that we could not actually return to our home because our house was rented. In the end, we decided that we had to go to the US because it might become impossible to get home later if travel was banned or airlines just quit flying. Also, while our own health insurance has access to international care, it's not as comprehensive as our usual coverage in the US. So, armed with antibacterial wipes and hand sanitizer, we took on 2 airplanes and 3 airports. A strange ending to our stay in this manner, worthy of a storybook, but no stranger than many of your stories from this strange chapter of our lives.
Thank you so much, Anne. That was really wonderful to listen to, and I'm sure we'll have a lot to talk about in our conversation. I want to remind everybody who's watching to send us your questions via the Facebook chat. I have my cell phone right here, and they will show up here, and I can forward them to the panelists if you like. My first question how do we get a Harlaxton Manor for IUPUI? I don't think we should answer that right now. Unless there's a very generous alumni watching today, they might
please
be Harlaxton Manor. it's really interesting to hear these talks together. What I think we're seeing, and all of you are talking about, is notions of community, communities that range from folks supporting each other kind of in patchwork ways, to use a term that you mentioned, Anne, to more integrated systems. And the ways that we think through this transformation from a patchwork system to an integrated system with each other. And each of you had framings that are kind of very useful to think about this through. So empathy in Emily's presentation, it brought up, as I was listening to you, I was thinking, you're talking about the notion of empathy in this kind of clinical context. But in the time of COVID-19, what empathy is has shifted in our conversation. We're not just talking about the empathy that clinicians have towards their patients, but we're actually beginning to talk about the community empathy for folks who work in healthcare themselves, which is kind of an interesting thing. So there's this community context in which empathy is happening right now that was not before COVID. So not quite a question, but a framework that I want to ask you to, and we'll come back to that in just a second, if you don't mind. Krista, you brought up this idea of an ensemble mindset. And just like in Emily's presentation, I was thinking, what does an ensemble mindset look like beyond, just a few folks working together, to an ensemble mindset for a larger community or communities to come together as ensembles, and what that means for our healthcare system? So I was just wondering if maybe you could reflect on that a little bit. To those two issues of this idea of our shifting notions of empathy and this ensemble mindset, and I'm wondering if you might be able to speak about those in relation to the work that you've done looking at international healthcare systems and the ways that folks there might be framing. You mentioned clear messaging in your presentation, but there's also, you also implied this very clear messaging coming from the healthcare systems themselves and the way the governments understood the healthcare systems. So those are not necessarily questions, but just general areas that I'm asking each of you maybe to kind of reflect on and talk about a little bit. So I don't know who wants to get started first. Emily, you maybe had the most time to think about it.
Sure. Yeah, sure. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I think we need to add into that community, into that sort of expression of empathy, those of us who are suddenly on Zoom giving lectures and talks when we really don't know what we're doing in terms of managing screens. And so we should be empathetic there as well. It's interesting. So we do generally think of empathy as that which our clinicians have for patients. And that's really, really important. And there are a lot of things we can do to, like I said, to rebuild the empathy that most of us really have throughout our lives and then lose for whatever reason. Well, for a number of reasons. And like I mentioned in my talk, a common response, a very common response to this idea that we need to build empathy among our caregivers is that we don't have the time to do that in training or in practice, and it takes too much effort and energy to be empathetic, right? If I am expected to be empathetic with every single patient throughout my day, I've got nothing left. But what we know is that as we develop our own personal empathy and we're able to express that to others, our patients, we actually do better. Yes, this crisis has absolutely cast a different light on our caregivers. We see them differently. We recognize more the enormous weight and responsibility that they carry. But I think that we can remind, that it's important to remind ourselves that we should even more build up this humanities-based, social science-based education that builds the capacity for personal empathy, because it prevents, helps to prevent burnout. It helps to prevent sort of this incredible emotional exhaustion, or at least decrease it among the caregivers. And that's incredibly relevant during a time like this. We know, unfortunately, that over the course of medical school, students become less empathetic, but also just really sort of down, unfortunately. Again, not always, but a colleague of mine, Dr. Catherine Head in Communication Studies, and I are doing a study right now looking at fourth year med students' perceptions of their first year selves. So we asked them to write letters to their first day of med school selves, right? What do I wish I would have known? And we're learning so much from those letters because, things aren't going really well. Med school's really, really hard. So there, in the best of times, there are lots of things that we can do. And then, I think times like this, or this is really unprecedented for us, reminds us even more how important that is, not only so that we can express, empathy and compassion and provide really good care, but that we, being the caregiver, I'm not the caregiver, but right, so that the caregivers can survive the care that they have to provide. They have to provide, right? So I could go on and on, but I'll stop.
So I've been thinking about a related concept to empathy during all of this, and based on my research in Europe. The Netherlands healthcare system is very explicitly calls on the value of solidarity and expresses the belief in solidarity. And you might have noticed that the concept, one of the things that Angela Merkel said was translated as the word solidarity. And I think that it's not the same as empathy, but I think it can be related to empathy on a, we're not talking then about a one-on-one basis, but on a sort of communal basis, I guess. And so I've sort of knew in a book learning sort of way before this whole trip and talking to people more explicitly about their healthcare systems, that there was this, you know, concept that some countries relied on the idea of solidarity to build up their healthcare systems, but I understood it so much better after talking to people. I mean, it's just very, it's very much at the forefront of their minds that this is a national value. And I think it is, or can be at least, related to empathy. So I think it was really interesting for me to hear you talk about it in the way that you did.
And you bring up a really good point there that I think connects to this concept of ensemble mindset that comes from the theater tradition and from the medical tradition, right? Because the opposite of that is sort of this sense of individualism, right? Of being sort of the star of the show, right? I am deserving of that spotlight. And I think that that's one of the things for me that is so interesting about thinking, what does it look like to apply these concepts in some of these really uncertain scenarios in which no one will solve this problem by themselves, right? Mm-hmm. It's not like someone is going to be in a room by themselves coming up with a vaccine or, solving the hospital bed problem. And so I think even more, it means sort of thinking about what does it look like to shift that mindset. And then from the patient provider standpoint, Emily, as you talked about it, thinking about like, what does it look like to make your practitioner, you know, if you think of your practitioner as a scene partner, what does it look like to make your scene partner look good in that space? So giving them the benefit of the doubt that they've seen, you know, a patient every 12 minutes all day long, and now they're here to see you and may respond in a way that is not necessarily as empathetic as you would expect. My good colleague, Elizabeth Weinstein, is an emergency medicine physician, and she always starts her, when she works with a new learner, starts with the idea that if you are in the emergency department as a patient, it is never your best day. Mm-hmm. And, you know, kind of going from that, like, no one here is having a good day. And, you know, for you, this is your everyday work. And so thinking about kind of how are you really taking that perspective of that other person and putting it into the way that you provide care, whether that's at the system level, right? So I was in Poland a few years ago, and I had a student that had a medical issue. We were waiting outside the urgent care, and I know just enough Polish to be dangerous, but I was watching as so in the Polish urgent care system, it looks a little bit like the minute clinic. So everyone waits out in one space. You put your name in, but essentially you sort of triage yourself. And there was a group, there was a family that was sitting there with a small child and then two adults who essentially negotiated with the parent and the child to let them go first. Right? It was like, I know that you have this upset baby who's crying, clearly running a fever. You guys go ahead, whatever our problem is, you know, we can deal with it a bit longer. And my student who was sitting there with me sort of remarked on like, well, how did they do that? And I, you know, they don't have the, you know, sign up sheet with the, you know, the electronic sign in form that the Minute Clinic has. So they can negotiate among themselves those things, and they do. And so I think that you're right to say that there are sort of attitudinal opportunities to learn from, you know, some of those international spaces, as well as just the simple logistics of how do those systems work. So how does Germany have the stockpile of PPE that we weren't able to have? And I think more broadly, for me, it makes me think of, and Emily, you might know her work as well. Lorelei Lingard is a rhetorician by training, and she has this great concept called collective competence. The idea that certainly there are times when really competent people can come together and make an incompetent team. And what is it about making a team come together, you know, those really high functioning teams? What's the difference between the group of competent people that come together and make the incompetent team versus those who come together and make the competent team? So I think kind of studying, you know, what is that group mindset that makes that group function together? And a lot of what she's found is focused on this idea of us coming with different perspectives and different strengths. And really foregrounding those in our day-to-day work.
Yeah.
So Anne, I wanna send a question your way really quickly before I move on to a question for everybody that has come over Facebook. One of the things that we didn't get a chance to talk to today that I thought you could remark upon is in comparing those different international healthcare systems. We know that when we look at the US, there are huge inequities built into our social structure and our economic structure, and they break along issues of race, class, gender. And we know that there are very clearly different health outcomes for groups based along those broad categories. So looking at the US, how have the countries in Europe that you've looked at dealt with those similar issues?
That's a good question. I probably need to take that up into my the future interviews as I go back to that project, or at least hopefully go back to that project, or maybe I'll have to go virtual if not. There are inequalities in those other countries as well, although I can't speak right now about exactly how they're handled in terms of the systems. I can say that one of my greatest concerns about this whole crisis is related to inequality. And the European countries have some sort of safety nets in place that, or maybe this is answering your original question to some extent, they have some safety nets in place like paid sick leave, and we have our the British Studies faculty back at Harlaxton, who's they're all English, there's four British Studies faculty, and then all the Americans like my husband who come to visit. They've recently been furloughed, but furlough there means that the government pays 80% of your wages, and then in this case, Harlaxton is making up the other 20%. They don't have to go through an unemployment insurance office. It just happens that the employer just reports to the government that they're furloughed, and then that happens. So they just are, it's very seamless. So there's some other social policies. There are stronger social policies like sick leave and unemployment and things of that nature that are stronger and providing just a stronger safety net than we have, at least when you take the US as a whole.
Oh, thank you. So, wow, more questions are coming in. This is fantastic. So one of the questions that's come in from the audience is that it's their understanding that in the US, historically, hospitals founded by religious denominations have had an outsized responsibility in serving the poor. And then this person asked, to what extent is that the same abroad? But I would maybe broaden that question out to ask Krista and Emily to think about the religious dimensions of the arguments that you were making about notions of empathy notions of kind of building trust and the notion of kindness and in working with each other and the ways that religion maybe has historically played or how that might be playing out in religious affiliated hospital systems, which I think is what the original question is getting at.
I'm gonna extend a little bit outside of my comfort zone, but I have a couple of things that I could say about that or that come to mind. They may not be getting at what the what's being asked, but I was gonna dive into history, but Jason, that's more you, not me, and so I should, and Bill may be watching, and that would be just I would get it wrong. What I will say is you know, this comes up frequently when I'm working directly with undergrads or with medical students or residents or fellows, even for that matter. And we think a lot about what it means to care for those who have very different beliefs than your own. And that happens frequently. And those conversations become even more poignant, you know, in times of great suffering or at the end of life. There are a lot of different kinds of resources to examine to help with those kinds of conversations. But when I'm involved, we go to the literature and we look at different stories, both fiction and nonfiction, where people from all over the world, all different beliefs, values, religions, are writing about or have been written about, and we consider them. How would we respond if this were our patient? How would we respond if this were, you know, our doctor or our nurse? What would our interactions look like? And we try to recognize where we are when we begin those conversations, and if we can make any moves, you know, throughout the process of the conversation to sort of recognize where we may have been stuck, you know, because we all get stuck, of course. That's kind of one way to think about it. I was going to go to the sort of historical roots of hospitals, but the religious roots of hospitals, but, you know, we'll save that for another night, or a historian, medical historian, I know a few.
I think that I'm not a historian either, but I think that historically there were these, there was a lot of religious groups in different countries, you know, sort of picking up the slack or addressing poverty. But I think that I'm really not an expert on all the different types of hospitals in all these different countries. But my sense is that when they developed these systems that I spoke about, it was sort of those holes were meant to be, whether they were fully plugged or not, but they were meant to be plugged. And whereas in the US, they have maybe been, that's less true because we haven't ever done that whole sort of full-fledged system. So there's greater responsibility either expected of or religious organizations or religious organizations expecting it of themselves.
I think Anne and Emily bring up some really good points that probably lead well into some of the philosophy of what I'll talk about here. I think, Jason, you know that I've done a series of conversations recently between faith leaders, people from the faith community, and scientists in Indianapolis, using some of these techniques from improv that are really designed, again, to kind of help communities to find a sense of common ground. And I think that you're right historically to say that particularly hospitals that are religiously affiliated have borne the brunt, if you will, of providing care for our underserved communities in a bunch of different ways. And I think that one of the places, at least for me, that is a fruitful ground, if you will, for conversation is around this space of kind of thinking outside ourselves, right? Thinking, you know, using that more sort of collectivist mindset to argue for resources, right? We know, for example, that that the social determinants of health are often much greater than the, you know, actual medical issues that folks encounter in terms of access to care, in terms of access to healthy food, access to time away from work to take care of yourself. And those kinds of support networks, as Anne said, right now we have lots of little siloed systems not working together. So being able to sort of use that ensemble mindset to say, how do we do more of what this particular group is good at and let them do the things they're good at, sort of get out of their way so that we don't have, organizations trying to do too much. And I think that that's one of the places where here in Indianapolis in particular, historically, we've seen lots of faith-based organizations, I think sort of, as Anne said, fill those voids where our social services haven't been able to deliver. And I think it's interesting to hear the places where that happens in other countries as well, particularly, again, at a time like this where our system is just incredibly taxed. So I think that ensemble mindset, again, for me, kind of comes to, you know, how do you identify what it is, not just that a person does well, but an organization does well, and help them to do more of that.
To what extent do you think, we had some comments here about the notion of solidarity come up, and I'm just going to ask you to just imagine a little bit. Let's say we have a politician who comes forward and starts using frameworks like solidarity. Krista, I think you just said we're a collective approach to healthcare. How does that play out in the United States? And if there's kind of a communications focused or oriented approach to that, what does that look like?
So I can talk a little bit about some of the work that my colleagues have done around climate change, because I actually think that that's a really good example of a place where we've seen folks who have very different political perspectives and maybe to some extent different values or sets of values that come into a conversation from a different place, but can agree upon a value, and agreeing upon that one set of values is what moves it forward. So if you look at my good friend Michael Hamburger, who's on the faculty in Bloomington and has been working recently with the evangelical community church in Bloomington to have really wonderful, positive conversations around creation, care, and climate change. Sort of thinking about from the perspective of folks in that church, the idea that if you are a person of that faith and you believe that God has created this space for you, that it's your responsibility to take care of it, right? That notion of understanding creation care in that way, and then climate scientists coming together and saying, you know, some who identify as people of faith and some who do not, but who say, I agree with you, right? It's my responsibility to take care of this place. And so there's some great work that's done around decision science that looks at this, that's simply asking folks to change their rhetorical frame to think about where are the places that we do agree or that we do have space of common ground, and then how do we amplify that as a part of our conversation? So whether that's appreciation of the natural world, sense of wonder is something that you hear lots of faith communities and scientists can come together to talk about, but what does it mean to have a sense of wonder? And how does that help us think about policy in different ways? So I think that there are good models out there. The American Academy for the Advancement of Science Division of Science, Ethics, and Religion has done a really wonderful video series that sort of looks at this space in between, not just science and religion, but also even if we're talking about questions around bioethics, for example, that I think is really powerful and interesting.
So I did a couple of weeks ago, I did a Google Trends search on the word solidarity. I don't know if you've done Google Trends before, but Google will tell you the peak of during the time period that you're looking at of the searches for the topic of solidarity. And then you can see that the peak is 100, and if you're at 50, then on that day there were only half as many Google searches for the topic of solidarity. And my surmise was that had gone up because I had just felt that I had seen the word solidarity more often in reading the news, etc. And sure enough, it did. It went, the searches for the word solidarity went up quite a bit. I can't remember exactly how much, but it actually started a little bit before the virus hit here, although it's a little hard to pinpoint, so it might have been later. But it was really a pretty substantial rise. I haven't checked in the last few weeks. I was interested in it because I do think that I'm interested in the possibility that this crisis that does point out a lot of our connections more than some types of crises, you know, that you could give it to me, I could give it to you, you know, that if you're not social distancing, it may affect me, et cetera, et cetera, could change our, what's possible politically with respect to health policy. More recently, kind of more or less after I was doing some of those searches, we've seen more political unrest, if you will. But I don't know whether that's a vocal minority and that there's still been a increase in solidarity in other parts of the population. I think that's yet to be seen, really. I am thinking about that possibility that there, this is certainly going to have a lasting effect on us, and probably in ways we can't at all imagine. So some people have said, when I bring up this possibility of an increase in solidarity, kind of like rolling their eyes and be like, right, well, wishful thinking, I guess. But I think it's going to be a huge impact that we can't really predict right now, and that there might be some, that would be a positive thing in my book if that kind of increase in solidarity came out of this.
Great, thank you. I have four questions. I'm only asking you to answer one of those questions. I'm going to pose it to all of you as a group. You can choose which question you want to answer, but we'll end with these questions because these are really useful for me and the audiences who come to these events. So, here are the four questions. Number one, what should we read? Number two, what should we watch or listen to? Number three, who should we follow? And number four, what should we do? Feel free to answer any one of those questions.
Okay, I'll start. So what should we read is my favorite question. So other than should we make coffee, which is my second favorite question. And the answer is always yes. So what should we read? So Frankenstein, should read Frankenstein for sure. Frankenstein had its big sort of rebirth a couple of years ago for the 200 year anniversary of its publication. But it's always a good time to read Frankenstein because it always applies to what's going on. And it absolutely applies right now. So I'll show this again because I got flustered at the end of my talk and didn't have time to really focus on it. But read Frankenstein and think about the kinds of things that Mary Shelley brings up, over 200 years ago that are really applicable today. But also I will say to read this really great book that came out, I think about a year ago, called The Great Believers by, I think, Rebecca Mackay. I wish I had it right here with me, and I don't. If I did, I wouldn't even be able to find it. But I think it was the runner-up for the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction maybe last year, something like that. It's about the AIDS crisis in the 80s in Chicago, and it is beautifully written, and I think it would be really, I read it just to read, and then I read it to teach, and my students loved it. And I think it would be an interesting book to read right now in light of what's happening. I could go on and on, but reread Frankenstein and check out The Great Believers. I thought it was really, really, really well done. It's fiction, just real fiction.
Fantastic, thank you. And you look like you have something in mind.
I'm gonna offer up not follow like Twitter, but follow like visit some websites if you're interested in these kinds of issues that I talked about. One is I think that both of these came through probably in the comments. I had suggested some links. But the Johns Hopkins COVID-19 dashboard has so much information. And, you know, if you're curious about different countries, you can find out all sorts of things. I didn't have this in the talk, but the New York Times is not only mapping, you know, you can see these maps in the New York Times of where the outbreak is worse in the U.S. and all of these things. But you can also see by state, and you can see, I've downloaded all the data by county. So you can see what's happening on a day-to-day basis in your own county or some county you think you might want to visit. And then also the other resource that I cited in the talk was the this is related to a site called the Kaiser Family Foundation site, which has KFF, which has fabulous health data. And this Peterson, then there's sort of an offshoot, the Peterson KFF Health System Tracker. So who knew that there was, you know, probably not many people were expecting me to tell them that there was a whole website devoted to health system tracking, but there is, and it's great data.
Thank you, Krista.
I had all this time, so I have a great big long list, but I'll try to narrow it down. So I mentioned the work of the amazing Paul Hibbett, and I would encourage you to follow him on Twitter. I think his handle is something like Jazz Doc. I'll certainly put it in the Facebook chat. Paul does great work that is around sort of creativity in clinical care and is just a fun follow on Twitter. And he always shares amazing jazz music. That said, re-listen to Miles Davis' Kind of Blue. It really is just a beautiful example of how Miles is so much better because of his great band. I mean, where else do you get the amazing John Coltrane, Miles Davis, Phil Evans all together at once? So gorgeous. Comedy Sports, which is one of our local improv groups, is doing really fun online bouts. So, and they're family friendly as well. So if your family is looking for something fun to do, you can just go to the Comedy Sports Indie website and take a look at those. And in terms of kind of on the more academic side, two things that I would recommend. Keith Sawyer is a faculty member at UNC Chapel Hill, and he has a great book that's a couple of years old called Group Genius. For his sabbatical, he went to some of the most creative organizations in the world and observed kind of what made them creative. His work is just really outstanding. He's also a jazz musician. And then the other, fun thing that I would recommend is if you're thinking about these improv concepts and you're like, Krista, I don't know, I'm not an actor, I'm not buying into this stuff, I would encourage you to listen to, instead of read, Amy Poehler's book, Yes, Please. She reads it herself along with lots of other famous people that you might know, like Seth Meyers and Kathleen Turner. It's very funny and very smart and really undergirds a lot of the success that she's had, both as a comedian and as an amplifier of women's voices, that is really focused on kind of how connecting with others and saying yes to things that you might be afraid of has gotten her a lot of joy in her life and a lot of opportunities. So some fun things and some more heady things.
Wonderful. Well, thank you all once again for joining us tonight and giving us such great things to think about and such fascinating insights. I really appreciate it. And also to the audience, thank you for sitting in on this. As I stated at the beginning, this is the sixth out of seven quarantined conversations. So we're getting to the end. So I invite you to make sure to join us next Tuesday at 8 p.m. But in the meantime, be sure to check in on Thursdays at home with the IU Arts and Humanities Council, which is also online. And be sure, if you've enjoyed what you've seen, go back and look at our previous quarantine conversations. They're all online on Facebook. You can watch them and encourage your friends to watch them as well. It's really great to see that these have lives after they're posted online, and the viewership keeps going up. So once again, thanks for joining us. I look forward to seeing you all here next week.
Thank you.
Thank you.